If you do not get this amazing new generation of Donkey Kong madness, you are stupid.
Hey guys, I know it's been a while since we last looked at some random monkey game trivia, hasn't it? I already went over Donkey Kong Country 1 in my last video, so this one will be about the sequel. That video is required viewing to enjoy this one. It's obvious that most of the enemies from Donkey Kong Country 1 were either replaced or redesigned for Donkey Kong Country 2. The same can be said for DKC 2 and 3. For example, these beaver enemies in the first game are basically the same enemy as these rats from 2. They just walk left and right and die in one hit, so they only really differ in terms of how they look. What's less obvious is that zingers were actually redesigned between Donkey Kong Country 1 and 2. I mean, it's pretty noticeable when you put the two sprites right next to each other, but it's strange that they even went to the trouble of slightly tweaking the sprite when the actual design effectively stayed the same. If you look really closely, you can see that the zinger sprites used on the map screen are also using their DKC 1 sprites. This one is amazingly unnoticeable since the sprite is a whole 19 pixels tall, but when scaling both the DKC 1 and 2 zinger sprites down to the same size, it becomes clear that it's the DKC 1 design. We'll come back to these bees in a bit, since there's actually a surprising amount to say about them. Regarding claptraps, they're also in the camp of enemies that got a redesign in subsequent games, but had their names changed. Claptrap, Clampin, and Crimp are the exact same thing from a gameplay perspective, but for some reason when Rare decided to give them a new coat of paint in each game, they also decided to rename them. It's not a big deal, but it always kind of bugged me. Like, did they really need to go the trouble of remaking an enemy that you can't roll into from the front on three separate occasions? Of course not, but hey, can't really criticize them for putting in the extra effort. As I already mentioned, claptraps were in an early version of the game. This whole time I've just been calling the game Donkey Kong Country 2, but of course this game's full name contains a subtitle, Diddy's Kong Quest. Now you may not think it, but this seems to trip a lot of people up. I've seen a lot of random comments on YouTube or Twitter or other places where people admit to remembering this game's title wrongly for years on end, and I'm sure if you go to an upload of this game's soundtrack, you'll find comments like that too. The title is Diddy's Kong Quest. You know, it's supposed to sound like Conquest. But it seems that people remember it as Diddy Kong's Quest. I can see how this happens. It's just the S that gets moved around, and when you think of the character, you obviously think of Diddy Kong more than Diddy's Kong, so it kind of overrides the correct title in your memory. Well, it turns out that the game's original title actually was Diddy Kong's Quest, as evidenced by this trailer from 1995. So if you saw this trailer back in the day before the game itself was released, and actually heard the guy say it, of course it would add to the confusion.
It's Donkey Kong Country 2, Diddy Kong's Quest.
And I mean, come on, who actually reads the title screen? Speaking of which, the same trailer shows an earlier version of the title screen complete with a little chest opening animation that's completely absent in the final game. Maybe Rare just wanted to change the title for the sake of the pun, but it also could have been changed to accommodate for the Japanese title. Just like Donkey Kong Country was called Super Donkey Kong in Japan, this game is called Super Donkey Kong 2. The little banner at the bottom just has text saying Dixie and Diddy. On the subject of pre-release content, there isn't as much compared to DKC 1, but that's to be expected. When you're developing a game like the original Donkey Kong Country, which was a reboot of the Donkey Kong brand, of course you're going to put forward a lot of new ideas that are up for consideration, but never make it off the drawing board. For a sequel, you know what you're working with. The characters and world have already been established, so the ideas put forward are generally more in line with what you'd expect from the series. So this sadly means there wasn't a proposed plot where Wario becomes a pirate and tries to raid DK Isle. Well, I guess you're not on Donkey Kong Island in this game. We're on Crocodile Isle, the heart of the enemy territory. The Kremlings have currency here, and they aren't going to make it easy to collect it. Of course, you've got bananas and Kong letters from the last game, but now there are banana coins, Krem coins, and the elusive DK coins. Needless to say, with the amount of stuff to collect, it makes going for 100% a hell of a lot harder than the last game, but I don't think it's as overwhelming as in some of Rare's later games. I guess this kind of was the start of their affinity for having you collect a bunch of shiny gold things. Banana coins basically just exist to pay for different Kong services. Yeah, your family will only help you for a price now, and sometimes saving isn't free. But these coins are much easier to come by, and you can farm them pretty easily if you just replay levels a bunch. Krem coins are for unlocking levels in the Lost World, Always gotta love it when your reward for completing challenges in a game is more game. You can only get each of these once, and they only exist at the end of bonus rooms and boss fights. I guess the devs realized that in DKC1 you could just enter a bonus room and immediately choose to fail it, and it would still count towards your completion, so this was a natural fix. And lastly, there are DK coins, which are always the hardest to get. I hope whoever decided to put this one on the end goal gets ketchup water all over their next sandwich. You know, these things are actually called Cranky's Video Game Hero Coins. As you'd expect, their only real purpose is to see where you rank at the end of the game, amongst Yoshi, Mario, and Link. This is basically the closest we'll ever get to having an officially recognized version of CDI Link. Of course, next to the No Hopers trash can, we have Earthworm Jim's gun and Sonic's shoes. I'd like to believe that the Earthworm Jim reference is a response to something that appeared in the Sega CD game, Earthworm Jim's Special Edition. If you pause the game and press down, and CBAAABCBAAABC, Jim will wear the head of Donkey Kong with an arrow shot through it. And this is 100% a dig at Rare because it uses the updated design from Donkey Kong Country. Now, the Sonic reference is more interesting to me because while everyone knows that Sonic was created in response to Mario, you could kind of argue that Donkey Kong Country was like a response to Sonic. I remember hearing that the more aggressive marketing of Sega vs. Nintendo occurred more so outside Japan, and while the Mario devs kept doing their own thing, I'm sure this whole brand rivalry was more present in the minds of those working at Rare, a British company. DKC1 was actually released a month after Sonic & Knuckles, so the entire Genesis trilogy was coming to an end right as the Donkey Kong Country trilogy was just getting started. Sonic games always had small elements of 3D in them. I've heard that the palm trees and the checkerboard patterns of Green Hill Zone were meant to be a direct reference to early 3D graphics, and the background objects in the Sonic 1 special stages looked like flat-shaded renders. Then, Sonic 2 and 3 both had their own takes on 3D with their own special stages, as well as the pre-rendered title screens for Sonic 3 and Sonic & Knuckles. There are other examples, but I think you get the point. Then Rareware probably went, "Yeah, that's a nice little title screen you got there, Sega, but what if we just, made the whole game pre-rendered? How about that?" They knew exactly what they were doing. The first ads for this game weren't exactly being secretive about it. "The first fully rendered video game ever. Where are you gonna find it? Not on Sega. Not on 32X adapters. Not on CD-ROM. It's only for Super NES." Yeah, come on, Sega. Nintendo would never release a shitty 32-bit console with less than 50 games made for it that would fail to sell even a million units. Anyway, I do think it's kind of interesting that Sonic could have inspired some elements from the Donkey Kong games. Things like having two characters on screen for both players, or the more vertical level design seen in DKC 2 and 3, feel a lot more in line with Sonic than with previous Mario games. Or even things like character-specific abilities like Dixie's Glide, or the ability for the Kongs to pick each other up, feels like it'd be at home in Sonic 3. There's also the air bubble mechanic that was cut from DKC 1 that I mentioned in the last video, which is an infamous staple of Sonic's water levels. I never really hear people talking about these things, but if you can think of any other similarities, please let me know in the comments. Alright, enough about blue hedgehogs. Monkeys and crocodiles are the main event here. Alright, here's a specific crocodile that's always bugged me. Clubba. This is the guy you have to pay in creme coins in order to access the Lost World. If you choose fight him, you don't actually get to do anything, he just instantly kicks you out. What I want to know is, if this guy's so strong that our main characters don't even attempt to put up a fight, why is this guy not the captain of the Kremlings? A single one of his arms is basically bigger than the Kongs you control, and you're telling me this guy couldn't beat K. Rool? I guess K. Rool always commanded creatures bigger than him, but I assume things like Naughty or the giant Nekis were beings of lesser intelligence. If we really want to talk about oversized crocodilians, there's this fucking thing from the Game Boy Advance version. Yeah, in the original, the level Stronghold Showdown was just a cutscene where they dangle Donkey Kong in front of you for a few seconds, only to pull him away and go, "Yeah, you got a few levels left." I guess to actually make it a showdown, they added Kerosene, this giant orange fire-breathing Kremlin thing. It's kind of reminiscent of the final boss of Donkey Kong, the 1994 Game Boy game, though I guess giant bosses with big hands are just kind of a trope at this point. I guess DKC 2 was the start of K. Rool's army expanding past just normal everyday jungle creatures. Not even death can save you from being part of his crew, since the first boss comes back as a ghost to take revenge on Diddy and Dixie for killing it. We also have the possessed sword Cleaver, those dickheads that throw things named Cloak, and this guy, Cackle. As if the cart levels weren't already stressful enough without a giant ghost skeleton chasing you, Cackle did lead to one of the most enigmatic beta characters, Mr. X. It's been stated that he was just an early design for Cackle, but a German guidebook that said he is a character that no one has known or has seen led people wondering if Mr. X was in the final game or not. Might as well talk about more random beta stuff. There are a few naming sheets that were once again released by Greg Males showing some early names either for the game or for the characters within it. I already mentioned that this game was going to be called Diddy Kong's Quest, to the point where a title screen with this name existed, but there were a ton of other names that were thrown out. I do kind of like Diddy Kong Country, it has a nice ring to it. You can tell they sort of ran out of ideas as you make your way down the page though. Diddy's Dilemma with Demonic Diabolical K. Rool. Mighty Morphin Power Diddy. Diddy in Space, even though he's not. Diddy's Desperate Search for a Good Name for this game. And of course, Diddy and Female with Hair. Yeah, Dixie Kong also went through a ton of names too. Some were alright, but some were pretty insane. I love that the first two suggestions were just Didette and Diddy Ann, really warming up the creative muscles there. We also have Denny, Daily, Dido, Diet, Drinky, Dalai Lama, Demi, Dem Girls They All Love Me, Dox, Dressed Up, Dolled Up, Dumpy, damn these are crap names, Diddy Girl and Donkey Girl, Ducks, and you get the point. Now, what I want to know is, what the hell is under these black bars? Surely it couldn't have been anything worse than Dicky Licky. Now, out of all these scrap names, there is one that kinda made it in. Dinky. This is Kitty Kong's name in Japan. There are also some pretty neat level concepts from this drawing board. Nothing too crazy, mostly just normal platformer stuff like jumping on barrels submerged in water, or a design for an auto-scroller level. The images will be linked in the description as always if you want to read them in detail, but they're mostly just things that did make it into the final game. This one interested me a lot though. It's a blueprint for the silhouette levels from Donkey Kong Country Returns. I know Rare didn't actually work on either of these games, but it's cool that Retro Studios reincorporated this idea so many years later. These are definitely some of the most memorable levels from the Returns games. Well, I guess David Wise did come back to do the music for Tropical Freeze. Donkey Kong Country 2 would still be a 10 out of 10 game if you played it on mute, but the soundtrack just elevates the game past the point of perfection. I don't know what these composers from back in the Super Nintendo era were doing, but DKC2 is one of those games that just has banger after banger after banger. Just telling you how good the soundtrack is would be a waste of my time though, who needs me talking over it? Obviously this game has tracks worth listening to any day of the week, but one mashup I always find myself coming back to is this one. I know video game mashups are usually kind of in your face, but this one is just very low-key, much like the song it's based on, In the Air Tonight by Phil Collins. I mean that more ways than one. Obviously I can't play it here, but the beginning of Bayou Boogie is a very clear homage to In the Air Tonight, which David Wise admitted himself. Some might call it a ripoff, but the rest of the song is clearly distinct enough that I don't think it's really infringement. I've heard people say that Flight of the Zinger sounds like a Killer Instinct song, which is another Rareware series, but none of the Donkey Kong composers worked on that game as far as I'm aware. DKC2 did have a few little nods to Killer Instinct. There is supposed to be a cheat code hidden in the Monkey Museum, but it was cut for whatever reason. Now I don't know much about the original Killer Instinct, but wouldn't it be cool if there was still some cheat code hidden in that game, but no one's ever found it because they never told you how to activate it in DKC2? Wishful thinking probably, but oh well. There is a poster of Chief Thunder, as well as a Killer Instinct arcade cabinet in the background. Dang, $2 is a steal. Cranky actually has a bunch of weird shit in this place. He has a Kremlin head mounted on the wall and a taxidermy display of Winky from DKC1. Like damn, I know he was replaced by Ratley, but you didn't have to go out and kill him. He also has this giant Super Nintendo controller back there, and this one actually changes depending on what region you're from. North America has the two tones of purple, while Europe and Japan have the original multicolored buttons. With only one exception, this is actually consistent across all the controllers in this game, from the main menus to the one in the background of the first K. Rool fight. And if you didn't already know that was there, well now you do. I also like the little touch of K. Rool still having some of the giant Nintendo bananas from the first game. The one exception to the controller thing is actually hidden in plain sight. When starting a new game, if you hit down on the D-pad enough times, you can access the sound test and then cheat mode. We'll talk about the actual cheats in a minute, but yeah, the 3 or 4 pixels on Dixie's controller are the same in all versions. One last thing about the museum is that in this pre-release image, it was actually On Guard in the tank instead of Winky. Maybe this means there would have been a different water-based animal buddy instead. Also, Rambi's there, or rather a golden statue of him. In the final game, it's a statue of Expresso, and I don't know if it's just me, but I did not notice him there until I saw the beta image. Expresso does have a greater role in the Game Boy Advance port. In the GBA version, they've added a new type of collectible, golden feathers. With no relation to the Banjo-Kazooie item of the same name, these are used for beefing up Expresso's stats in these newly added races. Well, it's more so that you just feed this tiny Expresso golden feathers to make him bigger. Hey look, Winky's in the background, and he's actually alive this time. This minigame is nothing special, but like, I'm just surprised that they added a whole new collectible that exists just for this minigame. Like, they probably had to add a feather into every single stage when remaking this game, all for a pretty mediocre racing mode. Okay, cheat code time. There are only two this time around. If you want the game to be even harder, input BA, right right, A left, AX, or barrel axe to get rid of all checkpoints and DK barrels. Gotta do every level in one clean shot with this code, though as consolation you'll always respawn with both Kongs. Apparently this doesn't work on boss levels though, which, okay, you could kind of argue that because you don't get checkpoints in the middle of a boss fight, it kind of makes sense to start you with one Kong. But apparently it doesn't work with Animal Antics, one of the most hellish and infamous levels in the series. Now, I'm not gonna play the whole game up to this point without checkpoints to test this myself, but you can apparently fix this by entering and exiting a level you've already beaten to get both your Kongs back. The other code makes your life slightly easier, and by that I mean it lets you start with 50 lives. Input YA select A down left A down, or ya sad lad. Now that's funny. But if you really want to make the game a cakewalk, at least if you're a completionist, the most powerful cheat at all doesn't exist in the cheat menu. Right at the start of the game in level 1, you can follow a specific set of steps to instantly give yourself all 75 creme coins. All you have to do is go inside K-Rool's cabin, immediately exit, never touch these two bananas, get this banana bunch, walk back into the cabin, get the 1-up, go get the banana bunch again, and finally the almighty creme coin will spawn. I've heard people say you can't touch the enemies or whatever, but as far as I know, the only conditions for when you do this is that you don't collect any bananas beside the designated banana bunch. Now if you do this, it won't count towards your completion percentage on the file select screen, so I guess it's not really ideal for completionists. But if you just want to see all the levels without having to make a detour for all the bonus stages, it's perfect. I think you can still go back and do all the bonus stages if you want to get 102% though, but remember, 102% requires you to visit every member of the Kong family and collect all those dreaded DK coins. Again, if you just want to play all the levels without the fluff of the bonus rooms, this is the best way to do it. Alright, everyone knows this one, and this is less of a cheat and more of a thing that the testers missed, but you can just fly over top of Screech instead of racing him like you're normally supposed to. Get fucked, Screech, your music is way worse than Sticker Bush Symphony. You know, I've heard a lot of people calling it Sticker Brush Symphony, and I thought it was just people misremembering and adding an extra letter, but it's actually called that in the GBA version. The original SNES soundtrack came first though, and it's still called Sticker Bush. We could just circumvent this and call it Bramble Blast, but that name is reserved for the Brawl remix. You know, I think we need to appreciate the UK a lot more. I don't just mean the United Kingdom where this game's developers are from, but I also mean Uncle Kong. Yeah, you know, Uncle Kong. The guy from this one Japanese strategy guide for DKC2. I can't believe you'd forget about such a beloved character who gives hints throughout this book. Here's another fun little oddity. Normally when you're on top of the honey in these levels, you can't walk normally, and the only way to move forward is to keep jumping. But when doing the piggyback thing, you can actually walk freely. Probably an oversight, but it could potentially make some of these parts easier. Speaking of the beehive levels, let's talk about bees again. I know they're wasps, but it's more fun to call these things bees. Anyway, as I mentioned in the last video, they scaled back the amount of zinger variations from DKC1. In that game, the color of the bees determined their flight path, and they were all able to be killed with barrels. In DKC2, bees can fly however they please. Yellow ones are able to be killed by barrels and other projectiles, but red ones are kind of invincible. Now, it's apparently a pretty universal claim that TNT barrels can destroy red zingers, just like how TNT can destroy their mechanical counterparts in DKC3. but there are no instances of TNT being anywhere near a Red Zinger in DKC2, meaning you can't actually try this out. But if we're gonna talk about glitches, there's none that compare to the Castle Crush glitch. Basically, in this level, you have to grab the DK barrel as Diddy. Then you put it down and immediately pick it back up when you're up against the wall, and Diddy will be holding nothing. Now, I could definitely see how someone could do this accidentally, but the worst is yet to come. When you release the Y button, Diddy will throw the invisible barrel, leading to all kinds of possible things happening. It can spawn enemies, change the palette, and even put you in a Rambi barrel. I would say that it's fun to mess around with for yourself, but you should not do this. For some reason, this glitch can reportedly affect the SRAM of the cartridge itself. SRAM stands for Static Random Access Memory, basically just meaning that this is memory that can be read and changed in any order, but it'll clear itself when it stops receiving power. Essentially, older games just use this to save your data, and to circumvent the data disappearing with no power supply, the cartridges came with a battery that provided energy when the console was off. If you've ever had to replace the battery for one of the Game Boy Pokemon games, you'll know what I'm talking about. Basically, all this means is that if the Castle Crush glitch writes something to SRAM in just the wrong way, it could make your game permanently unable to boot up properly. The only way to salvage it would be completely removing the battery so that the SRAM can clear. So yeah, unless you want to take a gamble with your DKC2 cartridge, do not try this on original hardware.
I really hate to do this another time, but this video will once again be cut short. If you want to stick around for the explanation, then go ahead, but if you don't want to be subjected to the usual YouTuber whining, then I'll see you next time. This video pretty much went through the most development hell of anything on the channel, even more than the fucking Zelda iceberg. I guess the correlation here is that these were both collaborative efforts, but that's besides the point. I originally made the first DKC video, and this one too, as a promise to a friend. But I kept putting off working on them because I wanted to do other stuff. Then I said to myself, okay, I'm not gonna upload any serious content until the second Donkey Kong video is done. That led to this huge gap in my uploads where my channel was pretty much dead for like a year. The video also got scope creeped to hell and back, though the final one that you just watched did end up having its scope scaled back a bit. Part 3 of this Donkey Kong series will materialize eventually, but for the time being I have a bunch of other video ideas I want to put my effort into. Videos that you may actually have a say in. That's right, I'm opening a Patreon, and for just $1 a month you can vote on a poll for what video I get to work on next. I do have one other video planned between now and whatever the result of the Patreon poll is though. That's all I have to say. Thank you for watching the entire video, including the outro. It does feel a little weird directly asking for money, but one thing I have no shame about asking for is something free, a like and subscribe. Yeah, I'm getting all the YouTuber begging out of the way today. For real though, you don't have to do any of that, and I appreciate anything, even if it's just a single view. I'll see you all next time. Goodbye.